Right, now we'll be discussing completely about the descending tracks, okay? And after that, we'll be finishing our discussion with the tracks, okay? Now, ascending tracks are those tracks which are taking the sensory information to your central nervous system. Descending tracks are those tracks which are bringing down the sensory information right from your cortex to your spinal cord. Clear so far? Right. Before that, you have to know there are some cortical analyzers which are located within your cortex. Now, what are these cortical analyzers? Are for example, this is your lateral or frontal view. This is your lateral section of your cerebral hemisphere, right? This is your frontal lobe, occipital lobe, temporal lobe, and parietal lobe. Clear? Now, here, everyone listen. Here, you have a line in the center. This is called as central sulcus. This is called as central sulcus. Before this, you have one more line. This is called precentral sulcus. Behind this, you have the next one. This is called as postcentral sulcus. Now, as a result of these three lines, this entire portion here, this is called as what? Precentral gyrus. Precentral gyrus. Now, I explained you what is sulci and what are gyri, right? Now, this is called as postcentral gyrus. Keep it in silent. Video is recording. So, this is precentral, this is postcentral, right? What did I tell you last time? Postcentral gyrus is also called as primary somatosensory area because all the sensations, they first enter into the postcentral gyrus. So, primarily they are entering here. The first point in the cortex where they are entering is this part. That is why it's called as primary somatosensory area. And this is called as primary motor area. Precentral gyrus is called as primary motor area because all the neurons from here, they descend down to the spinal cord. You are getting that? All the neurons, they descend down to the spinal cord, which are also called as their descending tracts. But anyways, there are some differences, I'll tell you. Now, if I draw two lines in the frontal lobe here, right? What will happen? This is called as superior frontal gyrus, right? This is called as middle frontal gyrus, and this is called as inferior frontal gyrus, okay? Now, in this middle frontal gyrus, you have got two more parts. This is called as anterior part of middle frontal gyrus. This is called as posterior part of middle frontal gyrus, right? Now, this entire posterior part of middle frontal gyrus is responsible for your activity, so-called writing. If I ask you, where is the writing area located? Where is the writing area located? Writing area is located in the middle, the posterior part of middle frontal gyrus, right? Next, what is this? This is your inferior frontal gyrus. Now, if I divide this inferior frontal gyrus, now this part becomes the posterior part of inferior frontal gyrus, right? Posterior part of inferior frontal gyrus. Now, this is responsible for, this is responsible for your speech production. Speech production. There is a special name given to this area. This area is also called as Broca's area. This area is also called as Broca's area. Clear so far, right? Another important thing is, if I draw, I'll explain you what is speech production and all in a minute. But before that, look here, in the temporal lobe, if I draw two lines here, this will be your superior temporal gyrus, middle temporal gyrus, and inferior temporal gyrus. Now, in this superior temporal gyrus, I divide this superior temporal gyrus into two parts, three parts. Anterior, superior temporal gyrus, middle, and posterior. This middle part of your superior temporal gyrus is responsible for your hearing. It means auditory analyzer is located in middle. If, for example, if I have damage of this area, then I won't be able to hear. The sensory information will be carried out because my ears, my ear ossicles, everything is working well. But at the end, the information is not taken up by this auditory analyzer. Clear? Coming to the posterior part, this posterior part, this one, this posterior part is also called as Wernicke's or Wernicke's area. Other name for this Wernicke's area is what? Other name for this Wernicke's area is posterior part of, where is this Wernicke's area located? Posterior part of superior temporal gyrus. Now, what is the function of this? This is responsible for speech articulation. What do you mean by speech production? Speech articulation is, see, for example, if I have any problem in my Broca's area, right? If I have any problem with my Broca's area, then I won't be able to spell the letters properly. You're getting it? I'll be talking like in this way. I won't be able to spell the letters properly. So this problem you call it as Broca's aphasia. Broca's aphasia. Clear? Okay. Next thing, if I have any problem in the posterior part of middle frontal gyrus, then I won't be able to write. Right? This is called as agraphia. Agraphia. This condition is called as agraphia. Next thing, what is Wernicke's area? If there is any problem in the Wernicke's area, then person can't be able to articulate the speech. There will be problems with the speech articulation. What do you mean by speech articulation is? For example, if I ask you, it didn't get me. Everyone, look here now. If I ask you, tell me the entire story, what happened, or else let's take another example. If I tell you, how did you come to the university? Now, what you'll tell? I got ready, I locked my door, I came down, I booked a taxi, and I came here, I opened the door, I paid money for him, and again I entered into the university. This is the entire story. It means the entire visual information, right? The entire visual information, you will recollect all that visual information and you will articulate it part by part in a series, in a story way, right? This normally happens because of Wernicke's area. For example, if there is any problem with this Wernicke's area, patient will have speech articulation. Speech articulation in the sense, in this patient, if I ask this patient, tell me how did you come to the university, he'll be telling, I paid the money, I locked my door, I came down, I booked a taxi, I came into the university, I opened the door. So in this way, the first things he'll be telling in the last things he'll be telling in the middle, and the middle things he'll be, you know, jumbling it. You're understanding what I told? So there is no problem with the speech production. The speech production is absolutely fine. But he is not able to recollect all the things and articulate in a proper way. Right? That is called as Wernicke's aphasia. So in this way, you have Broca's and Wernicke's. Next important thing is, for example, you know this one? What is this area? This is occipital gyrus. Right? It is responsible for your visual information. Vision. Done? Next, if I draw a line in the parietal lobe here, this entire thing, you see, this entire thing, this one becomes your superior parietal lobe. This superior parietal lobe is responsible for, stereognosis. What is stereognosis? You were there while I was explaining ascending tracts. Then I told you stereognosis. Very good. If I tell you to close your eyes and put some or the other thing in your hand, without looking at it, by palpating it, you will be able to tell this is a marker. If I put the keys, these are the keys. So this type of sensory perception is called as stereognosis. Clear so far, everyone? Right. Now, having said this basic discussion, look here. Now, before I draw the tracks, the descending tracks, I wanted to just make an outline classification. The descending tracks or the motor tracks, descending tracks are basically divided into two types. Okay? Basically divided into two types. So one tract, look here. For example, I'll just make a small picture of this. This is your cerebral hemisphere, right? And after that, you have what? What is this? Midbrain. After that, what is this? Very good, pons. After that, what is this? Medulla oblongata. And here you have your spinal cord, right? For example, if I draw a track all the way from the cortex down till the spinal cord, this track is called as corticospinal track, right? So descending, of course it is descending. So descending tracks are basically of two types. One is called as corticospinal tract, right? And the remaining tracks, they don't start from the cortex. Rather, they start from the midbrain, or some of the tracks start from the pons, okay? It means the remaining tracks are starting subcortically, below the cortex, okay? You're getting it? So these tracks are called as subcortical tracks. Subcortical tracts. So in the same way, you have corticospinal and subcortical tracts. Clear? Now, basically, any descending tract, ascending tracts, I told you, they have got three neurons. First order neuron, second order neuron, third order neuron. Clear? But the descending tracts have got only two neurons. See, from here all the way till the spinal cord, this is one neuron. And from the spinal cord to your muscles, this is the second neuron. So this first neuron is on the top, or second neuron is on the top? First neuron. So this neuron is called as upper motor neuron, and this neuron is called as lower motor neuron. Why I'm telling this? Because later on, when you are studying neurology and all, there are many diseases or there are many disorders related with the upper motor neuron and lower motor. You call them as upper motor neuron lesions, lower motor neuron lesions. Okay? Done. So this is the basic discussion. First of all, we'll be dealing with the corticospinal tract, and after that we'll go stepwise regarding the subcortical tracts. At the end, I'll make the complete table of all the ascending and descending tracts, and I'll compare from where they are starting, what is the function of them, and all of that. Okay? See, you have the notes. If you want, you can write, or else you can take a picture. If you want, you can take a picture and delete it later on. Fast. Done? No, don't put any filters for it. Directly take a photo. Right. So let's start with the corticospinal tract. Right, now you tell me, what is this? Midbrain, very good. And this one is? This is your pons. And here comes your? This is your medulla oblongata. And what is this? This is your spinal cord. And what is this? Another spinal cord. No, same spinal cord with another section. Clear? Right? Now look here. In this picture, here, this part of the cortex, what is this? I told you. This is your central gyrus, precentral, postcentral, right? Now what is this? Precentral gyrus, right? So for example, this demarcation here between the white and the pink, this is the precentral gyrus, right? Okay, let me show it to you like this. So this demarcation is precentral gyrus. Now I've cut this precentral gyrus, I've cut the cerebral cortex in which plane? Coronal section, right? After cutting it in a coronal section, I open it up. Now I have separated the frontal lobe. It means the frontal lobe, I have separated it out, and this is the precentral gyrus. Now I'm showing the precentral gyrus to you. So this is your precentral gyrus. Clear? Now, in this precentral gyrus, in this pre-central gyrus, you have cells all over in this way. The same way here also. Now, all these cells, collectively you call them as pyramidal cells. All these cells, collectively you call them as pyramidal cells. Now, some of the pyramidal cells are really big, right? So, these large pyramidal cells are called as cells of beds. Cells of beds. Any doubt? Right. Now, look here. Now, from all these cells of beds, what you have is, of course, pyramidal cell in the sense what? Cell in the sense what? This is a axon or what is it? Cell body, right? This is the cell body, and running down, I'll have my axon. So, these are my axons all over. These are all of my axons like this. Now, all these axons here, they are radiating inwards, right? They are having their radiating projections. All these axons are fanning in or radiating in, right? So, all these bundle of axons which are radiating in, so this type of pattern of radiation or fanning out or fanning in, this is called as corona radiata. They are radiating like a crown. So, this is called as corona radiata. Now, look, all these group of fibers, they descend down like this. All this group of fibers together, they form a corticospinal tract. So, they are descending down. These fibers, they descend down like this. Now, what happens when these fibers descend down? See, for example, this entire is the thickness of this fiber, right? This entire length is the thickness of this fiber. Now, look here. Out of all these fibers, just 10% of the fibers or 10 to 15% of the fibers, they come down all the way like this. They come down all the way. Look here. They are coming down all the way like this. And they finally end up in what is this? Anterior? This entire thing is the gray matter, very good. This entire thing is the gray matter, and surrounding you have the white matter. So, all this, finally this 10% or 10 to 20% of these tracts, they are coming down all the way and they are lodging or residing in anterior white matter or anterior column. I can also call it as anterior funiculus, right? Now, but the remaining 90% of the fibers, you see this 90% of the fibers, right? This remaining 90% of the fibers, what exactly happens is, for example, if I draw a picture of medulla oblongata over here, this is your medulla oblongata. In this medulla oblongata, you have got two important parts in this way. Okay? The center part of the medulla oblongata, these two things, the center part, these are called as pyramids of medulla oblongata. These two are called as pyramids of medulla oblongata. And the lateral parts, these are called as the olives of medulla oblongata. This entire part is called as olives of medulla oblongata. Now, why I'm telling this? The reason is, exactly here, let me draw it with, look here, exactly here in the center, you have the pyramids. On either side, you have the olives. Now, look what happens. In the pyramids, these two tracts, the 90% tracts, they undergo decussation. They undergo crossing to the opposite side. Okay? Now, after undergoing crossing to this opposite side, they all the way come down and reside in which funiculus? Very good. They reside in? Lateral funiculus. And after residing in lateral funiculus, what happens is they enter into which horn now? Very good. They enter into your anterior horn. Right? In the anterior horn, as I told you in the last class, you have got two motor neurons here. What are those motor neurons? Very good. One motor neuron is called as, this one is called as alpha motor neuron. And the next motor neuron, this is called as gamma motor neuron. Right? Same way here, alpha motor neuron, this is called as alpha motor neuron. And this is called as gamma motor neuron. If you have revised, tell me, alpha motor neuron supplies which part of your muscle? Alpha motor neuron supplies extrafusal fibers. Gamma motor neurons intrafusal fibers, right? Anyways, so if extrafusal, intrafusal, when they are supplied, they contract together. You're clear? Right. So this tract which is entering into the lateral funiculus, right? This tract which is entering into the lateral funiculus, you call it as lateral corticospinal tract. This tract is called lateral corticospinal tract. Lateral corticospinal tract is ipsilateral or contralateral? How ipsilateral? They are crossing so nicely. They are contralateral, right? Okay, the remaining tract, the 10% of the fibers, they are entering into the anterior white column. So I have to call them as anterior corticospinal tract. Now tell me, anterior corticospinal tract is ipsilateral or contralateral? Ipsilateral. Wrong. Look here, this entire thing is your anterior corticospinal tract, right? You know what happens when it enters into your anterior funiculus? The moment it enters into your anterior funiculus, this tract, they go to the opposite horn. In the same way, this tract over here, they enter into the opposite horn, opposite anterior horn. Now from here, you have alpha motor neuron coming out. You also have gamma motor neuron, the same thing. You have alpha motor neuron coming out and gamma motor neuron. Now tell me, anterior corticospinal tract is ipsilateral or contralateral? Lateral corticospinal tract is contralateral, not ipsilateral. Lateral corticospinal tract is contralateral, right? Where did the decussation take place? The decussation took place at the level of medulla oblongata. But whereas anterior corticospinal tract, the decussation is taking place at the level of spinal cord. You are clear with this, right? Now, what is the function of lateral corticospinal tract? The basic function of lateral corticospinal tract is, lateral corticospinal tract generally helps in the motor movement of your distal muscles. Motor movement of your distal muscles. Okay, lateral corticospinal tract is responsible for your motor movement of your distal muscles. Distal muscles in the sense, muscles of your hand, muscles of your feet, and all your fingers here, the distal fingers, all these fingers. Okay, so what type of motor movement is very precise motor movement? For example, if I'm typing, you need precise skills to type. If I'm playing a piano, you need some special precise movements to play the piano. So such precise movements are carried out by this lateral corticospinal tract. Clear? When I discuss about anterior corticospinal tract is responsible for your motor movement of your axial muscles. Motor movement of your axial muscles of my hands and legs are appendicular muscles. Muscles which you see in the single line, in the single axis, these are called as axial muscles. Clear so far? We have discussed lateral corticospinal tract and anterior corticospinal tract. Lateral corticospinal tract, fine movements. Anterior corticospinal tract, axial muscles, motor movement. You're done with this tract. Clear? Done? Now, the next tract we discuss on is about your which track? Right, the next track which we discuss on is subcortical tracts. All these are the cortical tracts. The corticospinal is a cortical tract, and the remaining tracts are happening below the cortex, so they are called as subcortical tracts. Right. So subcortical tracts, there is no need to draw the cortex. Okay, because they are arising from below the cortex. So this is your pons, medulla oblongata, and two sections of your spinal cord. Now, in the medulla oblongata region, you have got two nuclei. Okay, you have got four nuclei. See, this nuclei, simple picture of this nuclei is in this way. This on the top one, this is called as, yeah, tell me. The top nuclei, this is called as superior nuclei. This is called as inferior nuclei, right? This is called as lateral nuclei, and this is called as medial nuclei, right? Sorry, this is called medial, and this is called as lateral nuclei. Now, this is your superior nuclei, okay? This is your superior nuclei. These are the four vestibular nuclei. Now look here. This one is called as your superior nuclei. Okay? Nearer to superior nuclei, what do you have? This is called as your lateral nuclei. Lateral nuclei. Okay? Below the lateral nuclei, what do you have? This is called as your inferior nuclei. Okay? Next, this part which is highlighted, this is called as your medial nuclei. Right? So overall, how many nuclei we have? We have superior, lateral, medial, as well as inferior nuclei. Clear so far? These are the nuclei which are located in the medulla oblongata, and these nuclei are called as vestibular nuclei. Okay. Now, when I discuss about the lateral nuclei, other name for lateral nuclei is Dieter's nucleus. Dieter's nucleus. When I discuss about the medial nuclei, other name for medial nuclei is Schwalb's nucleus. Okay, Dieter's nucleus and Schwalb's nucleus. Now look about the tract here. First of all, let us discuss about the medial tract. Now this tract, what is this tract, by the way? Of course subcortical, but I have given a good discussion of about the vestibular nuclei. So from the vestibular nuclei, the tracts are coming down. So vestibulospinal tract. Now, this is your medial nucleus, right? From this medial nuclei, a group of fibers, all of them, they descend down like this. In the same way, here also, a group of fibers from the medial nuclei, they descend down all the way. Right? Now, these nuclei, they descend down all the way like this. And look what happens. These nuclei, they are residing in which funiculus? This is called anterior funiculus. They are residing in the anterior funiculus, and in the anterior funiculus, they take a turn and they enter into your anterior gray horn. Same way here as well. They enter into your anterior gray horn. Now, after entering into this anterior gray horn, what is the next thing that is happening? Here you have got alpha motor neuron. This is alpha motor neuron. Here you have gamma motor neuron. Right? As this is entering through the anterior funiculus, this is called as anterior vestibulospinal tract. Okay, this tract is called as anterior vestibulospinal tract, or other name is medial vestibulospinal tract, because the remaining tracts are going lateral to it. So when you compare it, it is on the medial side. This is called as medial vestibulospinal tract. Other way also you can tell is that this tract is arising from the medial nucleus, so I have to call this as medial vestibulospinal tract. Now, the next tract, I'll tell the function later, but let me write it down. This is your medial vestibulospinal tract. This is your medial vestibulospinal tract. Now, the next tract arises from the lateral nucleus. So, from the lateral nuclei, many axons, group of axons, all of them, they come down all the way. And they are entering into your which funiculus? This is lateral funiculi. right? They enter into the lateral funiculus, they come down again all the way, and look here, they enter into your anterior grey horn. Now after entering into your anterior grey horn, here you have got alpha motor neuron, you have got gamma motor neuron. The same thing on the either side, clear? This tract is called as it is coming through the lateral vestibular nuclei, I have to call it as lateral vestibulospinal tract. This is called as lateral vestibulospinal tract. You are clear with this, right? Now, when I ask you the functions of overall, when I ask you the functions of the vestibulospinal tract, there is only one function of the vestibulospinal tract, that is extension of your muscles. Okay? This is called flexion. Now, when I do this, this is called extension. So, extension activity, extensor activity of your entire body is happening because of vestibulospinal tract. But when you go little bit detailed, what happens is, when you discuss, this is your medial vestibulospinal, lateral vestibulospinal, right? Medial vestibulospinal is responsible for motor activity of your head and neck muscles. Okay, motor activity of your head and neck muscles in contrast to your eyes. I mean in coordination with your eyes. For example, what is the use of this track is, for example, someone is calling me. My eyes look that way, my head, my neck, all of these muscles, they are coordinated in such a way that my eyes, head muscles and neck muscles, all of them are looking at that direction. Now, if I cannot look like this. If someone is calling me, just I turn my eyes and my head and neck in this way. Will this happen? You do like this? No. It means you are associating or you are coordinating your neck muscles and head muscles in coordination with your eyes, eye movements. You are getting it? So this particular function is guarded by the medial vestibulospinal tract. And lateral vestibulospinal tract is responsible for your, as I told you, extension of muscles, or I can also write it as extensor activity of your muscles. If I ask you which muscles, then extensor activity of your, what muscles you have, I told you, appendicular muscles and axial muscles. It means muscles of upper limb, lower limb and axial muscles. So all the extension function is carried out by this lateral vestibulospinal tract. You understood this? So if I ask you single function of vestibulospinal tract, it is extension. Single function of vestibulospinal tract is extension of all your muscles. Now when I tell single function of vestibulospinal is extension, then there must be another tract which purely it is flexion, performing a function called as flexion, right? Now what is this tract? We'll be discussing it in a minute. But you understood this, right? Now let's hang on to the third track. Now this is the third track. Now last class while I was discussing ascending tracks, I told you that all the way from your midbrain to the medulla oblongata, which is also called as brainstem, you have mixture of gray matter and white matter. What is the structure where it has both mixture of gray and white matter? Very good. You have reticular formation in the center. So this entire thing, which is like a band in the center, this thing is called as your reticular formation. Now within this reticular formation you have got some nuclei. Okay, for example, this is the reticular formation of the pons, this is the reticular formation of the medulla oblongata. Now in the reticular formation of the pons you have got some nuclei. These nuclei are called as pontine reticular nuclei. In the same way you have got some nuclei in the medullary part. This is called as medullary reticular nuclei. These nuclei are called as medullary reticular nuclei. Now, when we look at the tract, how does the tract flow? Basically, look here. How does the tract flow? Right. First of all, let us discuss about the pontine reticular nuclei. Now, from this pontine reticular nuclei, you have got a tract. Now, this tract all the way comes down. And this tract resides. Look here. This tract resides in which horn or which funiculus?
Anterior
funiculus. After residing in the anterior funiculus, what will happen is it will take a turn, same like that. It will take a turn and it will supply two groups of muscles. What are those two groups of muscles? One is called as alpha motor neuron, gamma motor neuron. I mean two groups of neurons, sorry. Here you have alpha, here you have gamma. Clear? Now, this tract is called as ponto, right? Ponto, where is this ponta nuclei located? In the reticular formation. Ponto reticulospinal tract. Okay? This tract is called ponto reticulospinal tract. So, if this is ponto reticulospinal tract, then the next one will be medullary reticulospinal tract. Clear? Medullary reticulospinal tract. Now, this medullary reticulospinal tract, all the fibers come all the way like this. Now, these fibers, they come down. And they are entering into your lateral funiculus. So, all the way they come down like this and they enter into your lateral funiculus. After entering into the lateral funiculus, they enter into your anterior horn. Again, the same story. It supplies to your alpha motor neurons, it supplies to your gamma motor neurons. Right? Now, what is the basic function of pontoreticulospinal tract is? I mean, this, what is this color? Violet color. What is the function of this violet color tract? This one. This is called as pontoreticulospinal tract. The basic function of this tract is, look here, what it does is, it inhibits all your flexor muscles and it activates or stimulates all your extensor muscles. Clear? In the same way, when you come down to this red color tract is called as medullary reticulospinal tract. Now, what is the function of this tract is vice versa. It inhibits extensor muscles. It inhibits extensor muscles and stimulates or activates flexor muscles. Now, for example, see all the muscles which you are able to see here on the ventral part, from here till here, all these muscles are called as flexors, which are located on the anterior compartment. Now, when I turn back, all these muscles on the posterior compartment, they are called as extensors. Now, in this entire flexor compartment, for example, I am contracting these muscles. When I am contracting these muscles, what will happen? My arm will be flexed like this, right? There will be flexion of my arm. Now, when there is flexion of my arm, when my flexor muscles are contracted, in that time, the extensor muscles should relax. When I am extending my arm, extensor muscles are contracted and flexor muscles should relax. So, one should be activated, one should be inhibited. You are getting it? So, that coordination is guarded by this tract, the ponto reticulospinal and the medullary reticulospinal. Clear? So, overall this tract is called as reticulospinal tract. Okay? Overall this tract is called as reticulospinal tract. You are clear with this? Done? Shall I rub the corticospinal? Right? The last tract we'll be discussing now The last track which we'll be discussing is, look here, this is your midbrain. This is your midbrain. Now, in this midbrain, here you have got a dark colored structure. It is like a strap or strip. A strip of black colored structure you have in the midbrain. So, this entire black color thing is called as substantia. Substantia nigra. This is called as substantia nigra. Just above this substantia nigra, you have got red color nuclei here. So, these nuclei are called as red nucleus or nucleus rubar. Red nucleus. Clear? Right? There is nothing much to know about this track. Only one thing which you need to know is, from this red nucleus, the fibers come down. In the midbrain itself, these fibers, they cross. And they descend down. After descending down, again the same story. They descend down all the way through the lateral funiculus. They enter into the anterior horn and they supply to your, see, all the way they enter like this through the lateral funiculus and they enter into anterior gray horn and they activate your alpha motor neurons and gamma motor neurons. Clear? So, this tract is called as rubrospinal tract. If I ask you the function of rubrospinal tract, it is flexion of your muscles. So, if I ask what is a tract that is responsible for your extension of the muscles, it is vestibulospinal tract. What is a tract that is responsible for your flexion of muscles, it is rubrospinal tract. Very, very high yield. Okay, you have to remember it. Clear? So, this is all about the discussion of the descending tracts. Right? Now, you understood? Everyone? Clearly? Now, let us make a complete table of both ascending and descending tracts. Okay? So, if you want to remember all these tracts, it is your wish. Or if you just want to remember the table which I am going to write, that depends upon you. Now, first of all, we shall discuss the ascending tracts and then the descending tracts. Tract. Now, the first tract which we discussed in ascending pathway is? Yeah. Very good. Dorsal column, medial lemnis, not middle, medial lemniscus pathway. Right? Medial lemniscus pathway. Now, this track is taking sensory info or sensory information to. Where is it taking the sensory information to? I know it is cortex. Which part? Very good. It is taking the sensory information to your? To your post central gyrus, which is a primary somatosensory area. Post central gyrus. In this table, I am not mentioning the first order neurons and second order neurons. Just look at those pictures which I drew last class. So, that will be enough. So, it is taking the sensory information to post central gyrus. Now, after this, the next thing we need to discuss is where this tract is dissociating. Where is the dissociation of this tract? Dissociation of this tract takes place in what? Medulla oblongata. Right? Now, what is the function of this tract? Function of this tract. Basically, this tract has got two parts. One is called as fasciculus gracilis. Another one is called as fasciculus cuneatus. Fasciculus gracilis. What is the function of fasciculus gracilis? Fasciculus gracilis, I know it is lower limb, but what sensations is it taking from lower limb? Not pain. Vibration. Touch, vibration, proprioception, stereognosis, right? Touch, vibration, proprioception, stereognosis, all of them from where? From your lower limb. It is taking all such information from your lower limb. Now, the same information from upper limb is taken up by? Upper limb is taken up by this fasciculus cuneatus. The same information. Clear? Now, after the DCLM pathway, DCMLP pathway, the next pathway which we discussed was spinothalamic pathway. In that spinothalamic pathway, we have got two things. One is called as lateral spinothalamic tract. Another one is called as medial spinothalamic tract. The lateral spinothalamic tract takes sensory information to what did I tell you? The entire sensory information of your body is taken to post-central gyrus.